All right. Well, welcome everybody to this Ask Me Anything regarding my Liberty seminar. It's a Socratic seminar, and it's 15 weeks. We're talking about the principles of liberty and using the Socratic method to teach critical thinking. So first, let me introduce myself really quickly. I am an independent researcher and writer and podcaster. My website is called mereliberty.com. I have a podcast called Dare to Think. I have a BA in philosophy from ASU, and just some of my, you know, professional credentials. I debated a PhD economist by the name of Dr. Walter Block at the Soho Forum in New York City on a libertarian theory of abortion. And I was also invited to speak at the Christian Podcasters Association conference about handling controversial topics with grace. I'm a veteran homeschool mom of three and enjoy using the Socratic method with them. And I also helped establish an Acton Academy here in Albuquerque, and they use the Socratic method a lot with their students. So this is going to be the outline of our presentation. I'm first going to explain to you guys what the Socratic method is. Some people know what it is, others do not. Most people have sort of a vague idea of what it is. So we're going to go over what the Socratic method is. We're going to talk about course objectives, what we're trying to achieve with the 15 weeks of seminars. And then we're going to go over the course overview. I'm going to give you guys a little crash course mini lesson one. It's basically the lesson that I go over with my middle school students. And then I'm going to talk about the lesson flow between over the course of the 15 weeks and how that flow works. And I'll talk a little bit about internet safety and the applications that I use, and then we will open it up to your questions. Just as a reminder, I am recording this for the people who didn't show up, and also for other people who are interested in it. And so if you want to ask a question, if you want to ask a question and you don't want to have your video or audio recorded, you can use the chat box feature at the bottom of your screen, and I can read your questions, or you'll be welcome at the end of the presentation to unmute yourself and verbally ask your question. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started here. All right, so what is the Socratic method? Well, the Socratic method is not a monologue. It's not lectures. It's not a teacher giving information to students and having students sort of demonstrate that they have good memory recall and can repeat it back to me. The Socratic method is using dialogue to teach people how to critically think through ideas and evaluate whether they're good ideas or bad ideas, or to dive deep and dig deep into them to see what their merits are. And so this is really a dialogue between myself as a coach and the students in the group who are the peers. So my job is not to lecture, as I said. We'll actually use a video or a story or a reading of some kind as the object of the discussion. And my job as the coach is to facilitate the dialogue by asking questions. And again, the aim is not to it's not to just regurgitate the information and show that, you know, you have good memory recall. It is to talk about the ideas and really sort of let those ideas sink in and consider every aspect or every possible aspect of those ideas. And that helps our brain to really learn those ideas much better, and also make better decisions about whether or not we agree with them or disagree with them and how we disagree with them. And in this method, I encourage mistakes to be made and for healthy disagreement to occur. And when we do the little crash course, lesson one, that will become apparent as to why. Okay, so what are open-ended questions? So this is the difference between is the grass green, which is a yes or no question, versus why is the grass green? And I really liked asking this question of my students this year because I got a variety of answers, everything from a scientific explanation of chlorophyll and why chlorophyll makes the grass appear green to how the light spectrum works. But I also got answers from one of my students who considered it from an artist's perspective, which is how the green color of the grass plays with the other colors in the landscape, how there are different shades of green and this sort of thing. So when we ask an open-ended question, you can take it a variety of ways. That's really a helpful way to think through, you know, just the idea that the grass is green and why it is and how it is and that sort of thing. So this gets us evaluating beyond just pure information. It helps us to understand, you know, the author of the book that we're reading or the article that we're reading or the story that we're reading. It helps us to understand the speaker, why they're doing what they're doing. And it also helps us to understand our peers better. And it also helps us to make decisions and solidify our own beliefs about things or even change our minds. We might be persuaded a different way after considering the open-ended questions. There we go. Okay, so the course objectives, whoops, went a little too far. Hang on one second. There we go. There are roughly 14 course objectives. These are things that the students will develop over the course of the 15 weeks to varying degrees. And there's really no way to guarantee that they will develop these in exactly the ways that we want them to, or that you want yourself to. But these are some of the objectives. So independent thinking. So that's just, you know, the idea that you're considering these things apart from, influences from other people. Self-awareness, fair-mindedness, perseverance. There's one of my students, when he started disagreeing, was probably the only one in the group who took the position that he did. And so he demonstrated perseverance by really being able to defend his position and sticking to it. Compare and contrast. And this is what we do with analogies and disanalogies. And that's just, the example that I give is with like apples and oranges. So how would you compare and contrast apples and oranges? Well, we compare similarities between them. So they're both fruits, probably roughly the same size. They're both sweet. And then we contrast. How are they different? Well, they're different colors. They come from different fruit families. They do have a different sort of taste and texture to them. That sort of thing. The Socratic method also helps you develop your own worldview, which is just your own beliefs about the world and how you perceive things. It helps us clarify issues and beliefs. It helps us develop intellectual humility, which is just the idea that we don't actually know everything that there is and that there are other people in the world who have thoughts and ideas and information that we don't have. And that's a value in itself. Intellectual integrity, which is, you know, being sure not to have bad reasons for the beliefs that we have, even if the beliefs are good, having bad beliefs can really do damage, or excuse me, having bad reasons for our good beliefs can really do damage to those good beliefs. And so we want to develop intellectual integrity, intellectual courage. That's, you know, being able to, like that one student being able to hold his own in the disagreement and having the courage to do so, even though he was the only one with that opinion. Generalization versus oversimplification. So we can generalize things in terms of, like, for example, the apples and oranges. We can generalize that they're both fruits, but we don't want to oversimplify what that means. We don't want to say that because they're generally the same thing, that they are in fact the same thing. We also develop develop how we consider our emotions and how they connect to our thoughts. And this was something that I think all of my students were really surprised by. They weren't so much aware of how their emotions connected to their thoughts. And so this was a very valuable lesson for them. We also develop and analyze or develop the ability to analyze the meanings of terms and phrases. There are lots of words in our language that we don't always know what it actually means, or there's a colloquial use that is sort of off from the actual definition. And so we evaluate the etymology of words and the definitions of words and explore those things. And then we want to also develop confidence in reason. And that's just confidence in our own ability to think through things and evaluate. So those are our course objectives. So what do we do with these objectives? One of the things that we do is self-evaluation, and this helps to build that self-awareness and that perseverance. This is learning how to learn. And so this is really a skill that can be used with any subject matter. It doesn't have to be, you know, philosophical. I know somebody who uses this method to teach mathematics. You can use it to evaluate a piece of literature, you know, fiction. So this is really a way to learn how to learn, and understanding yourself, who you are, what are your ideas, how do you feel about these ideas, is this something that you can improve, what steps can you take to do that. So there isn't any grading in this. It's really a difficult thing for a teacher to be able to evaluate, mostly because I can't get into the minds of my students. I use this as an example. I'm an introvert, and I have several students who are introverts. And one thing that I've learned about introverts is that we think a lot about ideas, but sometimes have a hard time articulating our ideas. And the only way that a teacher can evaluate your thinking is through your articulation of those ideas. And so, but that shouldn't be a measure of how well you're actually processing through that information. And so I use self-evaluation, one, as an objective to develop self-awareness and perseverance, but two, so that the students can really take control of their own learning and also learn how to be self-critical without self-hating or that sort of thing. They can really evaluate where they are and what they still need to learn. And then we have group evaluation. And the way the group evaluation works is at the end of each seminar, which takes place weekly, we have our discussion, and then we give feedback to each other. And we talk about what the group did well and what we still need to work on. And this is also one of the ways that we might develop rules for the group. So if, let's say that the group is having a particularly hard time with discussing ideas that they disagree with, we might come up with rules that really help facilitate the disagreement so that we can work through those things and flesh them out without getting into, you know, arguments and losing control of the conversation, which so far hasn't happened, but that does give us the opportunity to do that. And there's an app that I would like to try that will help us with our self and group evaluations called Grow, which I will get to at the end of this presentation. But the group evaluation really helps us to work as a team and to collaborate on mutually beneficial goals. So everybody has their own objectives, their own goals, and we can work together to achieve those. So I really wanted to point out that the world kind of wants us to believe that the individual and community are at odds. But they aren't really. We are individuals living in community, and this is how we get along. We have to be able to think through things ourselves and learn how to be fair-minded and self-critical, but also be able to interact with our peers and exchange those ideas and offer criticism to them without being belittling or degrading or things like that. That's how we grow as human beings. And so the Socratic method really helps with that. So this is, like I said, for those of you who don't know, this is Adam Savage. He's one of the scientists from the show Mythbusters. And in this little presentation, he explains he explains how simple ideas lead to scientific discoveries. And so he talks about four different scientists who he's explored and talks about why they are important and how they achieved great things through simple questions. And so he talks about Richard Feynman and how he discovered his work in physics by asking a question when he was a child about why, when he pulls a wagon, why the ball in the wagon moves to the back as he pulls forward, why does the ball move back? And then he talks about a Greek philosopher, and I'm going to butcher the pronunciation. I want to say Anaximenes, I can't say it. At any rate, very ancient Greek thinker. He was actually the inventor of the term geography, and he had figured out basically the distance around the world by observing that in one place in Greece, the sun was straight over his head on the solstice, and at that same time, you know, several miles away from him in a different town, the sun actually created a shadow on that same day. And so just taking that observation that in one part of the world on that day, a shadow was created, whereas there was no shadow created where he was at, in this other part of the world, he was actually able to figure out the distance around the earth in ancient times without, you know, telescopes or any of the major technology that we have today. He also talks about Galileo and how he tried to figure out what the speed of light was. And he did a particular experiment where he and a colleague were sort of flashing light at one another, trying to guess and figure out what the speed might be. And he was the one that made a mistake. He was, as Adam said, orders of magnitude off. He was incorrect in his assessment of what the speed of light was. But a French scientist was able to come along and take that mistake, take that experiment, and expand upon it in a way where he was able to figure out what the speed of light actually was. And so one of the questions that we asked in this lesson was, why was that mistake important to the discovery of truth? And so we talked about how Galileo's idea was a good idea, And his attempt was good insofar as it gave this later scientist more information about how to maybe test this idea. But of course, he made the mistake, and he was off in his assessment. And so we talk about how making those mistakes, making an effort to try and make those mistakes, help us to evaluate our ideas and actually come to the right conclusions. And so I really encourage students to try and to make those mistakes. It's a safe place to make mistakes so that we can work through them and flesh them out and see if they actually hold weight. Okay, so this is the lesson flow. And the first five lessons, now I have courses for middle schoolers, high schoolers, and adults. And the lesson flow is the same, but I use different content to teach these ideas. And again, we can use the Socratic method with any subject, but I am using, in particular, I'm using principles of liberty in order to facilitate and teach critical thinking. So the lesson flow looks like this. The first five lessons deal with the self. So we ask, what are ideas? We discuss dealing with disagreements. This is where we also talk about how our emotions are connected to our thoughts. We talk about the relevance of personality to ideas. And in the adult class, we actually go over manipulation and how manipulation can affect the way we think and act. We go over the idea of education and what that actually is. And we also talk about the concept of self-ownership. And so those first five lessons are really focusing on the individual. And then the remaining lessons are about how the individual lives in the community. So we talk about these more liberty-minded principles, like the non-aggression principle, the rules of the market, how it works, and how we can break it. We talk about human interconnectivity. We talk about economics and intervention. We talk about the law, what it's for, what happens when it becomes corrupt. We talk about entrepreneurship. Producers and consumers, we talk about how money works, and then we talk about what happens when we're irresponsible with these things. So like I said, the first half of the lesson flow is to explore the individual, and students spend this time adjusting to answering open-ended questions. The students that I have in my middle school course come from a variety of backgrounds. I have homeschooled students, I have private school students, and I have public school students. And they're all at different places when it comes to being comfortable with answering open-ended questions. So we spend those first lessons where I'm really taking more of a leadership position in asking these open-ended questions so that they can learn how to think through them and answer those open-ended questions. And then in the second half, we're dealing with exploring how the individual lives in community. And so students are adjusting to this by asking open-ended questions themselves and learning how to disagree with one another and then working through those disagreements. So again, I want to reiterate, the world wants us to believe that the individual and community are at odds, but they aren't. We are individuals living in community, and this is how we get along. And so the Socratic method is very, very useful in helping build dialogues or dialogue with people with whom we disagree, which may be one of the biggest problems that we have in our world today. So I want to talk a little bit about the content that I use for the course. For the middle schoolers, I use the Tuttle Twins series of books. You can see some of those there on your screen. These are actually based on books that were written for adults, which you can also see there. And the idea is that the Tuttle Twins series has really taken, some big abstract ideas and cut them down to size so that kids can grab a hold of of those ideas and talk through them. The Tuttle Twins series is a wonderful series. My kids love it. I've never run into a kid who doesn't like them. They're really wonderful. For the middle schoolers, this comes with the Socratic seminar. I've got a really good deal from Connor Boyack, who's the proprietor of the Tuttle Twins. For high school, we use a combination of an economics book for high schoolers written by Robert Murphy. This is in PDF form, and it's not that can be sort of dry, and so I break it up with a video series called Out of Frame, which is created by the Foundation for Economic Education. Basically, it's created by a man named Sean Malone, and he takes popular movies like, you know, the comic book, the DC and Marvel comic book movies, among many others, and talks about these principles from the perspective of those popular movies. And so those are fun. And then for the adult course, we use a book called For a New Liberty by Murray Rothbard that also comes in PDF form. I've also developed some of the lessons, including the one on manipulation. So that's the content that we're looking at. And what I have to reiterate is that the goal here isn't primarily to learn the lessons in these books, although they are valuable lessons. The idea is to practice the skill of critical thinking through the Socratic method. So my aim with these things, we talk about these things, these are the object of our discussion, but my aim is to facilitate the critical thinking and working through these ideas. And so the students are free to disagree with what they come across, or to kind of branch out and talk about how the content affects other things. So it's not simply learning these principles, although that will happen just by nature of the Socratic method. Okay, so there are two applications that I use for the course. One is Zoom, which you guys are using right now. And Zoom has really amped up their security. I've been really pleased with it. You can find a white paper and more information about Zoom security now on my website, courses.mirrorliberty.com. Another thing that I use for additional security is with every registrant, I have a one-on-one initial visit, and this serves two purposes. One is to get to know the student, whether it's you or your child. And if you are looking at this for your children, I do encourage you to be with your children for the one-on-one visit. It gives us an opportunity to, number one, talk about what's to be expected in the course. But I also use it so that I can get to know each registrant before they come on and interact with everybody else. And this way I know exactly who's coming on. And then of course it's also password secured, so nobody can come on. There's another app that I want to start using. It's called Slack. Some of you may have heard of it. It's basically like a closed social environment. So if you can think of, you know, how Facebook works with posts and threads, that's sort of the same thing here. But it is closed. It is not public. It's invite only. And those invitations are approved by me, and only paid and previous students in the appropriate age category are allowed in each private group. So there's a private group for middle schoolers, there's a private group for high schoolers, and then a private group for adult students. And the same rules in the seminar apply in the Slack group. And that is where one of the apps that I want to use for self and group evaluations is at. It's called Grow. And I'm actually really excited about it because I can use it as a way to really track those 14 objectives that we talked about. Each student picks out 5 objectives that they want to work on in that one-on-one initial visit. And using this application called Grow, which is where you can do your own self-evaluation with the application, and you can invite others to give you feedback as well. And we can actually track progress in those objectives over time, over the course of the 15 weeks. And so that's super useful. Okay, now we are going to open it up to questions. So I'm going to stop sharing at the moment. I hope you guys all saw that, because while I share my screen, I don't get to see the group chat. So again, I'm still recording. If you don't want to be recorded, you can ask your question in the group chat, or if you don't mind being recorded, you can either unmute yourself or even turn on your camera. It's up to you. But I want to open it up to you guys. What questions do you guys have?
Okay, thank you.
I do have a question.
Okay.
What's the cost?
I'm sorry, say that again.
What is the cost?
Okay, so the cost is $200 per student, and that's for the entire 15-week seminar. That includes any of the content that we're working on. So if you have a middle schooler, you'll get the Tuttle Twins series. If you're a high schooler, you get the PDF, that sort of thing. But it also gets you access to the Slack group, and you stay in the Slack group even after the 15 weeks is over. So as long as your student remains in that age group, they can remain in that Slack group so that they can continue to practice those skills.
And when they transition to high school age, will they move on in that group, or will they have to retake the course?
So because we're working on different content, they will, it'll have to be, you purchase the new session. They'll stay in. If they're middle school, they'll stay in as long as they're middle schoolers. If you want them to continue on, you'll have to purchase the next level up. I am considering having a discount for ongoing students who want to, progress like that. I haven't had that experience yet, but I'm open to offering a discount for that. Let's see, Rachel asks, what kind of time commitment are we talking about for adult students? In other words, how much time do I need to budget per week? That's a great question. So I try to keep so you have a lesson that's given on Monday, and then we have a Zoom call essentially at the end of the week, and that's our seminar. And so the adults will be on Saturday, and high school and middle school students will be on Fridays. And so the lesson is given on Monday. I try and make the lesson no more than 30 minutes in length. Now, whether you want to spend more time thinking about it beyond that is entirely up to you, and I encourage that. But you really only need the 30 minutes to go through whatever the lesson is. And then the only other time commitment is the seminar at the end of the week, which is 45 minutes. Anybody else have questions? Thanks. Rachel says thanks. You're welcome. So one thing that comes up in the seminar that came up, it comes up frequently. I've done Socratic seminars with kids as young as elementary. And what usually happens is in the course of learning how to ask these questions, you have students who don't really know how to ask a question. In fact, it's the hardest part And it takes about 6 to 8 weeks, really, for students to get the hang of the seminar and the format and being able to feel comfortable asking questions or knowing what kind of questions to ask. And so at about 5 to 6 weeks, I start turning it over to the kids and having, or to the students and having them ask questions. And routinely what happens is the kids have a hard time coming up with those questions. And it's sort of like writing. And when I learned how to write, I had the hardest time just starting that first sentence. But what I learned was that once I got, you know, some ideas down on paper, once I wrote that first sentence, then things started to flow much easier. And so the same thing is with these questions. Once the kids start to get a practice in asking those questions, then the questions start to flow more easily. So that's something that comes up. Renata asks, when does this begin and how frequently is this offered? So, let's see, the fall course is starting on August 31st. That will be when the first lesson is given. And then the first seminar will be that following Friday or Saturday, depending on which course you choose. And it lasts for 15 weeks. And so it's offered 3 times a year. We have a fall course, a spring course, and then a summer course. Let's see. Rachel asked, is Socratic and dialectic similar? That's a good question. I don't quite know how to answer it, though, because I've heard dialectic used in a variety of ways. You know, the idea with the Socratic method is really to start the dialogue and getting students thinking about things. What happens frequently in these lessons, and one reason why I want to have the Slack group, is there are, whatever we're reading or watching, like that video from Adam Savage, there's a lot of ideas that can actually be evaluated in any given lesson. And so what we find is that we haven't been able to talk about everything that could be talked about. And that's totally okay. So, but the Socratic method is designed to get the students thinking about a particular idea so that they can start to own it and use it and apply it into the world. So I don't know if that's similar to dialectic or not. Any other questions? So if you are interested in registering, you can go to courses.mirrorliberty.com and there's a registration page there. If you do end up having more questions, you can always email me at Kerry, K-E-R-R-Y, at mirrorliberty.com, and I'm happy to answer those questions for you. And yeah, if you guys have nothing else, then we can go ahead and wrap this up. No other questions? Okay. Rachel says this was super helpful. Thank you so much, Rachel. So, okay.
Thank you for doing this, Kerry.
Yeah, thanks, Renata. I'm glad to do it. And again, if you guys want to reach out to me, you're more than welcome to. So thanks for showing up, and I hope to talk to you guys again soon.